بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على محمد خاتم النبيين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم افتح فتوح العارفين، اللهم افتح علينا حكمتك، وانشر علينا رحمتك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام، يا ذا الجلال والإكرام، يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. نويت التعلم والتعليم والتذكر والتذكير والنفع والانتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة والحث على التمسك بكتاب الله وسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم، والدعاء إلى الهدى والدلالة على الخير ابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته وقربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم. Respected audience, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gathered us here, alhamdulillah, on a beautiful topic to celebrate the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to celebrate the birth of Isa alayhi salatu wa taslim. What a grand tawfiq this is, and what a grand blessing majlis is, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah has blessed us with this majlis, that we can gather here in a state of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because there are many in this night that they're going to be in a state of disobedience to Allah. But the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala somehow deemed us worthy of being in a state of obedience at this very moment is a cause for us to say alhamdulillah. Say alhamdulillah. The more you say alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you an increase in that ni'mah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by your saying alhamdulillah, will give you tawfiq to enter upon majalis like this again and again and again. Doesn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the Quran, فَادْخُلِي فِي عِبَادِي وَادْخُلِي جَنَّتِي, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, enter upon my ibad, on my people, and thereafter find your Jannah. Thereafter find your Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us the taqdeem and ta'khir, and why He brings certain words first and some later, is the reason that He wants to show importance to the first thing, and that is the majlis of khair and barakah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us an indication to, that if you enter into majalis such as this, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you your Jannah, inshallah. That's your bait. That's your transaction today. That each and every one of us has to have a heart that is sincere in wanting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if that's sincere and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gazes upon our hearts at this very moment and He sees sincerity in our hearts, that just yearns for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by Allah, He will give you Jannah, inshallah. We have high hopes with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because He's the Rahman. He's the Rahim, and if we don't know that, then we don't know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one. We just do little things and Allah gives. We do little things and Allah forgives. That's the Lord that we have, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. What a grand tawfiq and a grand blessing this is, alhamdulillah. We spoke and we heard beautiful words by our dear teacher, Shaykh Harun. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve him, mashallah. That came all the way from Liverpool just to give us that bit of nasiha. That he saw in our community how we were being affected by batil and wrong beliefs, erroneous beliefs that were creeping into our hearts and our children and our next generations. That he came and he found it upon his time in his busy schedule that he came and told us about the great Prophet of Islam, Isa alayhi salatu wa taslim. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who manifests through all of this. Just like he said that this was kun fayakun, a matter of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam was us being shown who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that when He sent Adam alayhi salatu wasalam into this world, it was because of mercy for us so that we could be guided to the right path. And thereafter a time came when people forgot. There was a decay inside of that message. And what happened when people forgot? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't just leave us to it, but He gave us another prophet. Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam came later on. And after him, many prophets came, one after the other, when the messages were forgot. This succession of prophets and the message that they brought was all the same, one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we never forget. And we never fall prey to the shirk and the beguiling of the shaitan, who is ever waiting for us to slip so that he can say, got you. Because he knows where he's going, and that is the hellfire. But he wants to take each and every one of us with him. How many of us then are going to let him? Or are we going to put up a fight? Just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down a succession of prophets all the way until our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came into this world. Open the 30th juz of the Quran. Many of us would have read these beautiful verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making an oath in the Quran. A qasam. And why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even need to make an oath in the Quran? And if we want to give emphasis to our kalam, what do we say? Qasam. Qasmeh, whatever you guys say. These are the things that what we hear adi. Wallahi. Yeah, these are the things that you're going to hear adi in our speeches. But the reality is we need that so that we can give emphasis to our kalam. وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ قِيلًا وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ حَدِيثًا. Who can be more truthful than the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He doesn't need anything or swear upon anything, because we know that his kalam is asdaq. It's the most truthful of those kalam you will ever hear upon your ears. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a single surah, in the 30th juz, has made three oaths in one single surah. The ulama say it isn't to give emphasis to his kalam, but it's to show you who the things that he is swearing upon, so that we can have some sort of another special upon it, that we can lay emphasis to these things that are being sworn upon. First one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِالْخُنَّسِ الْجَوَارِ الْكُنَّسِ وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا عَسْعَسْ وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا تَنَفَّسْ. The three oaths that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making, I swear by the khunnas. The khunnas, the translation is the receding stars. Those that sometimes come forward and sometimes they disappear. And the reference being made over here is to the stars, not just the million stars that you're going to see in the sky. Because there are millions of stars that we can see, but unfortunately, due to the artificial light that we have around us, that we seem to sometimes block them out altogether. Go to a natural environment. Our brother Haddad, mashallah, he's just come back from the lands of Tarim. Ask him what these beautiful starry nights are like and how the beautiful sky looks when it's shining against the beautiful moon. That's a natural environment. So these beautiful stars, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making an oath by khamsa mutahayyira, or five specific ones out of them. Those that sometimes appear to you, and sometimes they disappear from you. All the other stars are going to be different. They stay on the eastern side, or they stay on the western side, and that's it. That's where the stars will remain. But these khamsa mutahayyira, or these five special stars, are those that sometimes appear and sometimes disappear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, I swear by these five special stars. The second qasam, he says, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا عَسْعَسْ. The second qasam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes reference to, is making a qasam upon, is the night when it comes upon you. The word is in the Arabic language is as-as. As-as is one of those who know the Arabic language, is a ismul addad, or those words that have opposite meanings simultaneously. Yani at the same time, it can mean aqbal and it can mean adbar. Or sometimes it means that when the night comes upon you, or when the night disappears from you, at the very same time. Just like in the English language, we have a word which may be like easy for us to understand. Maybe different in spelling, but the significance of the pronunciation is what I want to get at. We have the word raise, to raise a building, R-A-I-S-E. To raise a building from the ground means to raise it upwards. And to raise a building to the ground, the R-A-Z-E. Although the letters are going to be different, but the sound is exactly the same. One means taking it upwards, and one means demolishing it to the ground. That's exactly how this word as-as is. That it has two-way meaning. That when the night comes upon you, or when it disappears from you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's second oath to the night. And the third qasam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to make is وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا تَنَفَّسْ. Or when the morning flashes upon you, suddenly there appears out of the dead of the night, you see a beautiful dawn. We read them and we say, what is the speciality about the five stars? Or what is the speciality about the night? And what is the speciality about the dawn? We see a lot of night in England. We're used to that. There's nothing special about it. In the winter months, we see too much of it. But alhamdulillah. But what is the speciality? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy and send special nurs upon the mufassirun of this ummah that went into these Quranic verses and opened them out so that we could see it as they should have been intended. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted us to understand. Allama Shabbir Usmani, rahmatullahi alayhi, in his beautiful commentary on the Quran, he makes reference of this. He says, it isn't the speciality of Khamsa Mutahayyara or these five special stars. They're not special. Nor is it the speciality of the night or the morning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing upon. Rather, it is the inference or the indications what is referred to in them. He, rahmatullahi alayhi, says, with the inference of these khamsa mutahayyara, these five stars, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making reference to the five great prophets that came onto this dunya. Yani Sayyidina Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, thereafter Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, thereafter Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, then Musa and Isa alayhi salatu wa taslim. These are the five great prophets that came into this world. They came into this world and shone their lights into the world. And they stayed for a little while, but they had to go. Because this was a temporary fix. When people fell into decadence and error, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent these stars. They vanished just like stars tend to vanish. Like these khamsa mutahayyira, they went. The first reference is us to recognize the reference towards these anbiya that came and gave their khidmah for us so that we could have iman today, alhamdulillah. The second reference, it isn't a speciality, Allama Shabbir Usmani rahmatullahi alayhi says, it isn't the speciality of the night. Wallayli idha as'as. Rather, it was that period after Isa alayhi salatu wasalam left this world. That this earth was drenched and covered in this darkness. There was a cessation of what they class as Zaman al-Fatra. The Prophet ﷺ, in a beautiful hadith, he says, لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ فَتْرَ. For everything there's a cessation, a stagnation period. And when the stagnation of prophecy occurs, then there is no prophet in this dunya. There is no book. Everybody's forgot it. Nobody knows what right and wrong is. It is a dark age. And this darkness can only be taken away. وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا تَنَفَّسْ. And this pure brilliance that is needed to take away that dark. Allama Shabbir Usmani rahmatullahi alayhi says, this inference of this beautiful dawn is the coming of our Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that came into this world to take away all darknesses in this very month that we stand in today, alhamdulillah. And this Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, subhanallah, he came as a shining light to take away all the darknesses, subhanallah. The poet beautifully says, إِنَّهُ شَمْسُ فَضْلٍ وَهُمْ كَوَاكِبُهَا يَظْهَرْنَ أَنْوَارُهَا لِلنَّاسِ فِي الظُّلَمِ. He says, إِنَّهُ شَمْسُ فَضْلٍ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the sun, the beautiful sun. And all of the prophets that came before them, they're like his stars. Yani we need to know the stars, no matter how bright they are. When the sun comes out, the stars have to bow down. The stars vanish. That is the job of the sun. Here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has come into this world. But how many of us do even take this as a moment of showing joy? Put all your debates aside, whether we should do the mawlid or we should do this or we should send fireworks up into the sky or do whatever. But one thing that we do all agree upon, every mu'min, that we should believe in our hearts that was the happiest day of our life. Why? Because لَوْلَاهُ مَا خَلَقْتُكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't have created you. You are the gift to Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. understand it in that way and we can move on. The ni'mah and the blessing that has been given to us. لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. Didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say that there has come unto you a messenger from amongst your own selves? لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ صَفْوَتِي. My chosen one has come unto you. My مُخْتَارِ جَاءَكُمْ. My one that I've selected, the elect one, has come to you. What kind of a feeling do you have inside your heart when you hear لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you that I've sent upon you a messenger, and the best of all of messengers, the sun that was going to outshine all of the others, that was the stars. Salawatu Rabbi wa salamu alayhi. But when we see this and we understand this reality, then we know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came into this world. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he would read this very verse, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ, as we read the Qur'an, as we know that there are many, many qira'at or many variations of the Qur'an itself. And Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he would read this verse, he would read it to the Sahaba, he would read it with a slight variation. How he would read it, he would say, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفَسِكُمْ, مِّنْ أَنفَسِكُمْ, with a fatha on the fa. What changes in the meaning? He says, there has come unto you a messenger, the most purest of all of them. And then after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after finishing the ayat off, he says, إِنِّي أَنفَسَكُمْ نَصَبًا وَصِحْرًا وَحَسَبًا لَيْسَ مِنْ آبَائِي مِنْ لَدُنْ آدَمَ صَفَّاهٌ كُلُّنَا نِكَاهٌ. He says, you want to speak about me? I am the most purest of every one of you, full stop. I am the best of you in lineage. I am the best of you in sihr, in-laws and spouses. And I am the best of you in honor, full stop. He says, if you want to look at my nasab all the way to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, never will you find an immoral person. Min aslabi tayyibin ila arhami tahirat. That they were past my nur that was placed in Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, was placed in his back. And from pure loins to pure wombs that was spent every single generation. We don't have time to go into every single one, but that's a topic for another day, and it's a beautiful topic to speak about these individuals that were in the silsila of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the most nafis of all of them, the most purest of them. Look at the back, we can see the beautiful the kids that have done the entire nasab of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam along the back. This is their contribution, so that we can understand who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was and who his nasab was. Now you want to speak about the likes of Malik or Fihr. Fihr, the one who Quraysh is named after. You want to speak about him, that he was the best of all of them. That when he walked in the marketplaces, all people could see was Nur in the forehead of Fihr ibn Malik. What a rank that would be. Why? Because he carries the Nur of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We speak about the great Abdul Muttalib, the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What a beautiful individual. Yani a one who had been entrusted with giving the food and drink to all the Hajjaj. And everybody in the whole of the Arabian Peninsula had to fall and lay prostrate in front of him in a way of saying that we submit to your leadership. And you're a leader of the pure sense. And he was the one at whose hands Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the bitter of Zamzam be manifest, that was dug, and he was hidden away until Abdul Muttalib, and he saw in a dream that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the three nights in succession, that he saw dig the well of Madnuna. He says, what is Madnuna? He says, the dream went. The second night he sees a dream. He says, Ihfir Barra. He says, dig Barra. He says, what is Barra? He says, I don't know. And he went off in his dream. The third night he says, Ihfir Tayba. He says, dig the well of sweet success. And he was shown the exact location. And as soon as he started to dig, he had one son with him at that time. Abdul Muttalib only had Harith. That was the eldest son of Abdul Muttalib. And as he starts to dig, he finds gold. This was the hoarded or the lost treasures of the Quraysh. And what happens is that when he found this, all of the Quraysh started to fight with him. Significant. Why? Because he says that, look, I found it. Finders, keepers. Losers, what? Weepers. That's what Abdul Muttalib said to the Quraysh. But what happens? That Harith comes to his rescue. But who is Harith? One individual. Yani father and son to defend this entire place. He found it hard. Thereafter what happens? That he makes a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Ya Allah, I was left without anybody to defend me except for one son. By Allah, Ya Allah, if you give me 10 strong sons, I will slaughter one of them in your name, Allah. Slaughter his own son. And look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has it. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't give him one, doesn't give him two, but gives him full 10 that he asked for. That's yani 11 sons, including Harith. He's got 11 sons. And he forgets about his vow that he made to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then we see later on in his dream, he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends a voice in his dream. He says, Udhkur, yani, Ufir bi nazrika, ya Aba Abdul Muttalib, li Rabbi hadhal bayt. Beautiful words. He says, fulfill your vow. Don't forget your vow for the sake of the Lord of this Kaaba. He wakes up and he realizes, I forgot. I have to kill or slaughter one of my own sons. But which one am I going to kill? All of them are beloved to me. He says, but let me try. So he drew lots. And guess whose name comes up? The one who he loved the most. And that was the youngest of them. Wherever he would go on a travel, he would always find his youngest one, Abdullah. He was the youngest of the sons, and he was the one who he cherished the most. If he went on a journey, he would take him with him. He's not letting him out of his sight. Yani, when he would sit in his musnad next to the Kaaba, he's a leader. Nobody would dare sit in his place except Abdullah. He was allowed to sit in his place. Abdullah's name came. He says, how can I kill my own beloved son, Abdullah? I love him. And this is the one that I have to kill. But he says, but I've made an oath to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Lest some calamity befalls us, I have to fulfill my oath. So he takes a dagger in his hand. And he's just like he's done with his grandfather Ismail alayhi salam. He's about to slaughter him near the Kaaba. And the sisters of Abdullah are the ones that stop their father. They said, don't do this. What are you doing? He says, maybe we have one particular way. Why don't we draw lots against 10 camels? You draw lots against 10 camels and against Abdullah. And if the name of the 10 camels comes, then you slaughter the 10 camels and your son is free. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's way of telling you that you've been let off the hook. So he draws the lots. The name of Abdullah comes. He draws it again. He says, try again. Maybe we're second time lucky. He draws it again. The name of Abdullah comes a second time. Oops. He does it a third time. The name of Abdullah comes again. And we see that he keeps doing this and he keeps doing this until he gets to a mi'ah, 100 camels. And when the 100 camels come, thereafter he does it and the name of the camels or the camel's share comes. And he slaughters 100 camels in the vicinity of the Kaaba. Abdullah is saved. Abdul Muttalib is going to be one of those beautiful individuals. That when we saw that the rank of Abdul Muttalib was only until Abdullah was born. And as soon as Abdullah is born, all eyes are on Abdullah. Let's put Abdullah away for one side. Abdul Muttalib is going to be very, very famous. More importantly for one incident that he did in his life. Other than winning, yani finding this Zamzam. And that is how he saved the Kaaba against Abraha and his armies. Abraha was an evil one and time is short, or we could go in the entire beautiful story of Abraha. He was a Christian, yani a king from, yani from the people of Abyssinia, who was resident in Yemen, in the south of Arabia. And what happened was he vowed, he says, why are all the people visiting the house of Allah in Mecca? He says, I'm going to build a huge cathedral. And he had ivory brought in from the palaces of Sheba. And he had beautiful pearls and rubies brought in from India and all of the other places that he could think of. Yani, this cathedral was the best that money could buy at the time. And his own purpose was that he wanted people to leave the Kaaba and come to his cathedral in Sana'a, in Yemen. But long story short, what happened was there were some mischievous ones from amongst the Banu Kinana. The Quraysh are one clan and the Banu Kinana are the other clan of the Arabs. So the Banu Kinana, two men, went to this cathedral. Two different riwayat. The funniest one of them, I'll tell you, that they went in and they all need to cause mischief or to provoke Abraha into kicking off. So what do? They go into this cathedral. And what do? They defecate and urinate inside the Kaaba, inside this cathedral of one. And when they do this, they make themselves aware, make sure everybody sees it. And then they begin to run. And they're off running. And they made sure every god along the way saw this. Abraha was angry. And he's having none of this. He gets an army that's going to be so fierce and strong. And at the head of it is going to be Unais. Unais is the leader of this army. He's a general, if you will, who's going to be controlling all of the elephants. There are these war elephants trained in only battle. They march with one intention, and that is to destroy the Kaaba. How dare they do this to my cathedral? I will make sure that I'm going to sort them out. And he goes, and along the way, any northern tribes that he sees, he captures them and he kills them, every single Arab, except for one man by the name of Nufail. Nufail was a leader of the northern tribes of Yemen. So he captures him. And he tells him, he says, you will spare your life as long as you be a guide for us and take us to the Kaaba. This is your terrain, you're an Arab. And you've been to the Kaaba, so you have to, we'll spare your life, but you need to be our guide. And he reluctantly agrees. He goes along the way, and what he sees is they get to the place of Ta'if. And the people of Ta'if used to worship Lat and Uzza, Lat. And they said, if these armies come and crush our God, false God, then we're going to be annihilated. So they give one of their men. They said, we'll become a guide for you. And they were the first ones in the whole of Arabia to go against. And they were treacherous to their own kind, just to protect their own God, false God. This was the hal. Now what happens to this individual that becomes treacherous to the Arabs? He goes as far as 2 miles away from Mecca to a place called Mughammis. And what happens? This very one dies a painful death over there. To this day, if you go to the place of Mughammis outside of Mecca, slightly to the south of Mecca, you can see the grave of this person. And what do they use it for? The Arabs go yearly to stone this place, to say that we were not happy with what you did. Long story short, Abraha gets to the places on the outskirts of Mecca al-Mukarramah. And here he meets Abdul Muttalib. And as soon as he sees Abdul Muttalib, he comes off his throne and he sits down. Same level as Abdul Muttalib. Why? Ijlalan, for the nur that he sees in that face of Abdul Muttalib. Now what happens? He says, Abdul Muttalib, he says, I'm not concerned with Mecca. He says, all I want is my camel's back that you've taken. Give me back my camels and that's all I want. He says, what a Ajib person you are. And we're here to destroy your holy place. And all you're worried about is your camels. He says, Ana Rabbul Ibil, Walil Baiti Rabbun. Subhanallah. What kind of aqeedah would he have? He says, I am master over these camels. The house that you speak about has a Lord, and he will protect his house. And this is the aqeedah, what happens, that this Abraha, in his arrogance and his cockiness, that even at that point he should have said that was enough as a sign that we should have moved forward. But he tells Unais, the leader of these elephants, the leader, he says, go forth and attack. What happens, Nufail, this is the trick. Nufail, the one who they had captured along the way, he was hearing what Unais would say to the animals to make them advance or stop. And he said the words in the ear of the leader of these elephants. Nufail whispers these words. And these words coincide with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because as soon as he says these words, the leader elephant stops in his track. As soon as he stops, none of the elephants are going to move. Unais starts to beat these elephants, but to no avail. So Unais says, let us turn back. face the other way and go back to Yemen. As soon as they turn back, they start to move. He says, now turn back. They go to Makkah again. No avail. They don't want to move. The books record that if Abraha, even at this time, would have stopped and thought that this is a sign that I shouldn't go ahead, he would have been saved. But it was too late, because on the western skies they saw a dark cloud coming, and as they came closer, it was those small birds that had three pebbles that were annihilated the entire tribe of this Abraha and his entire army. Thereafter, Abdul Muttalib, because of his dua being accepted, became known as the man of God, and his people became known as the men of God. And it was almost 50 days after this beautiful day when we saw in the cosmos a change. We saw that the stars came close to the ground. We saw that the mountains that we would normally see besides Makkah al-Mukarramah and in the entire world, they begin to swell. We saw the seas begin to rise. We saw that there was no mischief in the lands. What was this except the signaling of the coming of our Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? That he came to this very son that we spoke about, Abdullah, that when he gave, when he spread this nur into Lady Amina from the Banu Zahra clan, he no longer has this nur inside of him. And after he passes on to the Amina, 2 months into the pregnancy, he passes away in Yathrib, leaving behind a wife, Amina, that was never, this child that was never ever to see the father's face ever again. Amina radiallahu ta'ala says that at that very time when I was giving birth, I felt the loneliness inside of me, that I didn't have my Abdullah with me, my husband, that could be at this generous, this beautiful moment to witness the coming of his first son. But it was nonetheless a joyous occasion, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to let her feel this loneliness. Why? Because at that time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes Sakina descend upon her. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends Bisharat in the form of true dreams, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells her, don't worry, for your son, lahu sha'adun min ash-sha'ad, is going to be a great affair. For your son is going to be the one who's going to be remembered and praised in the dunya and praised in the heavens, subhanahu wa ta'ala says. This is the one who's going to be given to you. And when you do conceive this boy, then name him Muhammad, salawatu rabbi wa salamu alayhi. What kind of a bishara, a glad tiding is she given? Thereafter, it doesn't stop. We see from the riwayat that the mischief that wasn't even affecting the dunya was because every single shaitan that was in the world was captured, and he was chained, and he was hung upside down, for the zillah for them, to show them that today is the day that you're going to be zaleel. There is no more izzah for you left. Because dark ages are going to finish by the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And after this, we see the Amina radiallahu ta'ala anha, that she doesn't feel any pangs of any pain, but she sees the easy labor. And what kind of a labor is this? That she sees light emanate from her, that she sees the Qusur, the white palaces of Sham, that begin to manifest. And where's Makkah and where's Sham? Subhanallah, and that distance, and she can see it, Mahajjat al-Bayda, like it's a clear daylight, that she can see it clear as day. And this is surprising, subhanallah, but she sees all of this, and this is the special thing. But we see that there was an earthquake that was done in Persia, these beautiful towers that the Kisra had erected, that was so strong that 14 of these towers collapsed to the ground. They're not just any old towers. In the ones that remained out of the towers of Kisra in the time of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he becomes Khalifa, he has the remaining towers demolished. And let's say it took each tower, it took 2 months, a full army to try to demolish it. That's how strong these were. But these were crushed in one single coming of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We see the Lake Sawa totally dry one night. We see the fires of the Persians, the Zoroastrians, that they would worship this fire for that was lit for over 1,000 years, extinguished in one night by the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What kind of effect does this have on our heart? And these are not just stories that we speak about or have nativity plays like the Christians do or whatever. And we say, mashallah, what a beautiful story. And I ain't a storyteller and I ain't here to entertain. But we're here for a real, real reason. Though, how do we connect? What are all these signs that Allah's Messenger ﷺ came with? Just like the towers of pride were shorn and crumbled to the ground when Muhammad ﷺ entered this dunya, we also have towers of takabbur and pride inside of us. If Allah's Messenger ﷺ enters our heart, these towers of vain arrogance and takabbur, what shaitan wants us to have inside our hearts, will crumble to the ground. Just like we have shaitans, and just like we have shaitans with each and every one of us, لِكُلُّكُمْ كَرِينَ, every one of you has a kareen with him, a shaitan. Just like he was shackled when the Prophet ﷺ came, if Prophet ﷺ comes into our hearts, we will see our devils shackled. Never will they be able to harm you or affect any of your actions or your speech ever again. This is the reality of the Muhammadan reality. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Hayati khairun lakum wa mamati khairun lakum." My life is good for you and my demise is also good for you. And in a beautiful hadith finishing off, he says, "Ni'mar rajuli ana li shirar ummati." How great of a person I am, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for the evil and wretched ones, the sinners of my ummah. So the Sahaba said, قِيلَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَنْتَ لِشِرَارِهِمْ فَكَيْفَ لِخِيَارِهِمْ. He says, if you're here for the wretched ones and you're here for the sinners of your ummah, then how will you be for the good ones and the pious ones and the muttabi'een of your sunnah? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, خِيَارُ أُمَّتِي يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةَ بِأَعْمَالِهِمْ وَشِرَارُ أُمَّتِي يَنْتَذِرُونَ الشَّفَاعَةِ. Allah, Allah. He says, the good, those who listen to me and my words and follow them, they'll get their Jannah due to them following me. As for the evil ones, as for the sinners, you and I, they are burdened with sins from morning till night. Our entire lives, we've disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We've neglected the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's speaking about us. He says, "Wa shirara ummati," and those sinners of this ummah. Those sinners of my ummah will benefit from me by my shafa'ah on the day of judgment. That he will be there to take us by our hand and to plead in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he takes us by our hand and takes us into Jannat al-Firdaus. And by Allah, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that I won't rest until each and every one of us is in paradise. What kind of a Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do we have? We owe it to him for the rest of our lives to say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, jazallahu anna sayyidina Muhammadan, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bima huwa ahlu. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the best of all praises, and best of all ajars, and the best of all rewards, and the best of all maqams, for the benefit that he's given to this ummah, that the benefit that he will give us on the day of judgment, that he will never forsake us, even in that time when even our mothers, our fathers and our loved ones will let us go. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our brief time, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us true ittiba and connection to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our gathering in this Rabi' al-Awwal and make it be a means of our maghfirah and our elevation to the rank of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Such words of wisdom from Mawlana Irshad, alhamdulillah. Take a moment to ponder upon these words of wisdom from Mawlana Irshad Sahib about the birth of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Take a moment to ponder upon these and have a sort of a 5-minute break where you'll be served tea and have the dates and the water aswadain, which is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So take a 5-minute break, and then inshallah after a 5-minute break, the Nasheed group Sham will be performing, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.